Ladies and gentlemen, allow me to welcome all of you formally on behalf of the India Habitat Centre and the Society for Policy Studies. Some of you have been here, I think, in the past, and you're familiar with the Changing Asia series. I'm very happy to recognize with us Mr. Rakesh Kakkad, who's sitting there, former director of the Habitat. He was one of the people who helped us to put this in place. And this has been going on now for 3 years plus, and the idea really, and I've said this in the past, I'm saying it again, that we felt that perhaps Delhi needed a forum, you know, which would nurture the equivalent of a public lecture, and that we would be able to sustain it. And we also thought that we would keep the choice of subjects as a very broad spectrum, though some of us, you know, who had initially thought of this both in the Habitat and at the Society for Policy Studies, Tarun Basu, our president, is also here. We thought we should move away from the familiar international relations, foreign policy, security, strategic, and widen the bandwidth to look at issues that would have a policy relevance and that would also be of interest to civil society, if I could put it that way. And this is across the spectrum of Delhi civil society. So this was the spirit, and we thought the frame of reference could be what we described as Changing Asia. That over the last few years, there's been a lot that has been said and written about the Asian century. And in passing, the focus was on both China and India, along with other major Asian countries. And what were the challenges? What were the opportunities? Would it be realized? Would it not be realized? So very broadly, we said Changing Asia. And we looked at a number of issues. As I said, it was not just foreign policy, not just security, not strategy. We also looked at health and education, amongst other subjects. And it's against this backdrop that today I have great pleasure in welcoming and introducing Mr. Pradeep Baijal. Now, some of you may have heard of him. I definitely had heard of him. I had not met him till this evening when we came here for the lecture. But those of you who have been looking at India's policy pursuit, if you will, you know, the way in which national policy has been articulated, particularly in the last 10, 12 years. Telecom is an issue, I think, that has received a lot of attention, some favorable, some not so favorable. And Mr. Baijal was involved, I would say, hands-on with the TRAI, the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India. And that's when, as I said, I had read about him and the way in which he had tried to introduce a certain amount of reform at the bureaucratic level. And furthermore, as I said, apart from TRAI, he is an officer from the Madhya Pradesh cadre of the Indian Administrative Service. And over the years, he has done a lot of work in power sector. He's also been involved with reforms per se. And I was just talking to him this evening over a cup of tea, and he sort of shared the fact that over the years when he was in the service, the government had given him opportunities to be trained in UK, in Japan, in Tokyo, in the agricultural sector, and in Harvard, where again I think he was given an opportunity to look at privatization, you know, which is now the buzzword in Modi 2.0. Now, apart from all this expertise that he had acquired and experienced as a civil servant, and this is what I've heard anecdotally, that there is a certain tenacity about Mr. Pradeep Baijal. You know, many of his batchmates from the administrative service are here. Some have shared, shall we say, you know, little bits of that only course mates or batchmates can possibly share. I'm looking at some people sitting here. But the gist is that here is a man who, after finishing with the IAS and receiving a fair amount of attention from the GOI, decided that he would study China. And he sure did study China, you know. And the net result is this particular book, by the way, which is outside for those of you who have not seen it. We normally do not plug books at the Habitat Center at these lectures. But I think today is an exception, because if you look at what he has put into this book, it's an enormous amount of research. And I think, like a good policy man, he has also tried, as you can see the way in which it has been framed, that not only is it about the miracle of China, it's also about lessons for India. And this is the part which I think is unintended, that today is the 22nd of October, 2019. 57 years ago, this country went through the trauma of October 20th, 1962. And more recently, a few weeks ago, we had Prime Minister Modi meeting President Xi Jinping in Mahabalipuram, now called Mamallapuram. And it's now called the Chennai Connect. And the Chennai Connect has a linkage with the Wuhan spirit, when Mr. Modi had gone to Wuhan and they had the informal summit. But the backdrop to both Mamallapuram and Wuhan was Doklam. And Doklam was about contested territoriality. And in many ways, Doklam can be traced back to 1962. And in the intervening decades, you know, from a time when in the 50s and 60s, if those of you who track China and know the numbers, India's per capita was ahead of China in the 60s. India's investment was ahead of China. And immediately after Tiananmen, there were all kinds of question marks about China. But those who are aware with China's miraculous rise know that in 1997-98, give and take a year, China's GDP was $1 trillion. In 20 years, it increases by a factor of 12 to 13. It becomes $13 trillion. And that is actually quite extraordinary. And in this period, the asymmetry between India and China has grown. Grown to a point where I think, you know, there are many lessons for India. It's something that is stoking India's anxiety. And both Wuhan and Mamallapuram, I think, were a holding operation for India to ensure that whatever happened between the two nations stayed within a certain agreed political framework. So I thought Mr. Bajal, with his background, has rendered yeoman service in studying China. And we've often had foreign service officers, I can see Mr. Shashank and other colleagues over here, writing and speaking about China. But very rarely have we had an administrative services officer looking at China. The only two exceptions I can think of are the late Mr. K. Subramaniam, who was our director at the IDSA, followed by Mr. P.R. Chari, also an officer from the MP cadre, who looked at China in different ways. So Mr. Bajal, allow me once again, sir, to welcome you and request you, the floor is all yours. He'll speak for about 30, 40 minutes, and then we'll have the usual question-answer session, time permitting. Sir, all yours.
Thank you, Mr. Uday Bhaskar, for the very kind introduction. This is a very complex book. At least for me, it was very complex. And before I introduce the subject today, that is, the learnings for India from the Chinese miraculous growth, I must explain why I wrote this book. I've dealt with that in the book itself. I wrote this book because in about 2000, we were doing mobile telephony. We were very successful. A little before that, in the IT sector, we were very successful. In the milk sector, we were very successful. The Chinese were very concerned, how is it that our poor cousin India is doing so well in these sectors? So their teams came to India. We were also invited to China. Their companies came to India, they sat down in my office as to how we had this miraculous growth. When all this was happening, I felt obliged to Government of India that I should write a book on China, on how China grew. I felt especially obliged because against the rules of Government of India, I was sent on three trainings in the area of reforms. So I started studying. When I started studying, I found a gold mine. I found a gold mine in the recently declassified documents of Indo-China, of US-China dialogue. They were treated as such secret documents that even today, some of the portions of those documents are blacked out. I went to various countries which were impacted by this, and in 3 years I was able to complete this book. When I completed the book, naturally, the draft was 550 pages. I gave it to some friends. There are some friends who are here who helped me write this book. So when I gave it to those friends, they said that, look, only the author reads 550 pages, no one else does. So I thought I must abridge the book, and I abridged it to 200 pages. But then I thought there must be material for those who are researchers, for those who are students. So I have used the format of extensive notes and references so that if there is a researcher, he can go in the notes and references and understand the whole subject. So that is how the book was found. I was also, during my studies, I also came across two books which are very interesting. One was Michael Pillsbury's book, and the second one was Kishore Mehboobani's book. Michael Pillsbury's book was 550 pages. Kishore Mehboobani's book on the same subject was 91 pages. When I looked at those books, I first tried to procure them. I didn't find the book in India. Ultimately, I found it in a Foreign Service library on way to the airport. So I got the book issued. When I got the book issued, I found that the book which was bought by that library in 2015, I was the first person to get that book issued. Why was this? Because this book was 550 pages. On the other hand, Kishore Mehboobani's book was issued every other day. So that is why this book is only 200 pages. I wish I could make it 91 pages, but there was a very comprehensive story to tell about all kinds of factors which impacted the Chinese study, and Commander Uday Bhaskar is absolutely right. Till 1990, India and China had the same GDP. So let me first deal with GDPs in general. In 1 AD to 1830 AD, 1800 years, India and China were 50% of the world's GDP. For these 18 and 30 years, all the countries had similar GDPs every century. There were no changes. Why were there no changes? There were no changes because there was no colonial rule. There were no new technologies. There was no extensive trade. So therefore, from 1 to 1830, the GDPs didn't change. Then came 1830, and a miraculous change happened. What was the miraculous change? In 1760, the first industrial revolution started. In 1760, the colonial rule started. And this led to a lot of the GDP became very volatile. 1830 to 1970, we come to 1970 now. 1830 to 1970, India and China, which were equal, which were 50% of the world, became 5%. There was a drop of 10 times in the GDP of these two countries. The factors responsible were new technologies, and the factor responsible was colonial rule. And that led to the GDP falling. What happened in England, where you had the first industrial revolution? In England, the GDP in this period used to be 1% of the world's GDP. It went up to 6% of the world's GDP in this period. What happened in the United States? United States had a GDP of 6%. It went to 30% of the world's GDP. Only one factor, one main factor, technology. First industrial revolution from 1760, second industrial revolution in the United States from 1900. So we now come to 1950, 1970. 1950, lots of changes happened in the world, both India and China. became independent. Both India and China could write their own plans. Both India and China could decide their own fates. The colonial rule ended. And the effect of the first industrial revolution and the second industrial revolution started waning. At this time, India wrote its plans under the guidance of Soviet Russia, and those plans led to the famous Hindu rate of growth. In China, Mao was more ambitious. He said, no. I have become a ruler of China, and I must overtake the United States. So he wrote a 100 years marathon. That 100 years marathon is beautifully described in Michael Pillsbury's book. But let me come back again to Michael Pillsbury's book. Michael Pillsbury's book didn't sell. So Michael Pillsbury did an interview with Haqqani. I wish I had done my interview with you earlier. So he did an interview with Haqqani, the famous Pakistani ambassador to the US. Now he has been turned out of the country. So he did an interview with Haqqani. It's one of the most beautiful interviews that I have seen. And it's a one-hour interview. After that one-hour interview came in the media, Pillsbury's book started selling. Because that interviewed abridged Pillsbury's book of 550 pages to 1 hour. Kishore Mehboobani didn't have to do this, but he also did an interview. And I don't remember who interviewed him, but if you go to YouTube and put How the West Lost It, an interview by Kishore Mehboobani, then it shows. So why I'm saying this, that since I'm not doing an interview with Commander C. Bhaskar, but I'm doing a kind of an interview. So these help to explain the issues better than the book itself, particularly if the book is 550 pages. Now, let me come to the first industrial revolution, second industrial revolution, and the end of it. In 1970, Mao made plans, 100 years marathon, and Mao made a fool of himself. Because what was the plan? Aggressive plan. We had the Red Guards, we had the Leap Forward, and we had many such names. That led to disastrous results. And China had another famine after 1950. And at this stage, Mao thought, we can't do any GDP growth. So let me go to the country which has the maximum GDP, and that was United States, and they approached United States to help them. United States said, nothing doing. We will not touch a country like China. But Mao would not give up easily. He got hold of Lee Kuan Yew, who was a native Chinese and was friendly with him, and told him, go and explain to Nixon why he should collaborate with China. So he went to Nixon and he said, look, if you collaborate with China, the effect would be that you will get a huge market for the American corporations who were stagnating. And he gave a draft article to Nixon. Nixon was standing for the election as president, and Nixon published that article in the famous magazine Foreign Affairs in 1967, and then he won the election in 1968. After he won the election, that article became a policy document. Many people in the United States, including Kissinger, didn't like that document. They said, no, this is very dangerous, we shouldn't do it. But the president had written that, and it became a part of the official conversation. At this stage, Mao got in touch with Nixon again. Mao knew that Nixon was very impressionable. So he got in touch with Nixon again through Lee and convinced Lee that he should pursue, that Nixon should pursue this policy. Nixon had a big problem with Indira Gandhi. At that time, there were only two countries in the world with this big population, and Mao knew that Nixon had a problem with Indira Gandhi. At one point of time, Nixon had called her a witch. So, when they discussed these issues in a meeting in 1972, which was fixed after much drama, the secret documents, which are declassified now, the secret documents say that Chavanlai and Nixon made fun of Mrs. Gandhi in that meeting, and they made fun of India in that meeting. Both would have given equal number of people with the same GDP to USA to include in the US bloc, but Nixon was very much against Indira Gandhi, so he picked up China. And Mao convinced him that we will move towards democracy. When all this happened, they did start moving towards democracy, but they found that when they moved towards democracy, the country became unstable. And he was able to convince Kissinger and Nixon that it's not wise to move towards democracy. Let us continue with the communism, and we will deal with the democratic issues later. One of the justifications for the United States to partner with China was that United States wanted to finish Russia, because Russia had overtaken USA in some areas. What were the areas? Satellites. Satellites were thrown up by China, by Russia first. And they had a Cold War and they wanted to finish. So US adopted two policies. One, take help of China, grow them so that China is able to finish Russia. Second, impress the leaders in Russia about the benefits of democracy. Both Yeltsin and Gorbachev were very impressed with the lectures about democratic form of government, and they pursued democracy very forcefully. The result was that the famous Russian Empire got disintegrated. Eastern Europe, states in USSR, everything got disintegrated. So at this time, there was no justification whatsoever to pursue with the China policy. But by this time, Deng had become the kind of president of the of China. He was a great strategist and a great man with a lot of deception. Deng convinced Nixon's successors that it was still advisable to include China in the American bloc, and the Americans fell for it. There were some other developments. The other developments were about technology. The first industrial revolution and the second industrial revolution started in the West. They kept the technologies very secret and benefited from those technologies. First industrial revolution, 100 years. Second industrial revolution, 100 years. By 1950, the third industrial revolution came. The third industrial revolution did not come in China or India. The third industrial revolution came in the West. But the technologies easily went to China and India, particularly to China, for three reasons. Number one, that United States wanted to help China, so the technologies went to him. Number two, you had the world interconnected, connectography, so it was difficult to retain your secrets and your technologies, etc. The third reason, Jagdish Bhagwati's globalization set in. And when Jagdish Bhagwati's globalization set in, then it was no longer possible to hold technologies to yourself, and the benefits of the third industrial revolution, whatever were the benefits, went to India and China and not to USA and UK. And therefore, the beneficiary of the third industrial revolution was mainly China, who got most of the technologies. There was another development. United States actively helped China to join the WTO. It was not eligible to become a member of the WTO. They were not following the WTO rules. But America, as is usual with America, only works in its own interest. And America helped China become a member of WTO in 2001. Russia applied at the same time and they were more democratic. But Russia was blocked till 2012. I have given graphs in my book and also in the note that I have circulated for the meeting today, where China and Russia went like this. China went like this and Russia did not progress because it was not a member of WTO. The Chinese labor and the labor of many countries, about 1 billion people, joined the WTO without any quid pro quo, with the result that China started producing goods very cheaply. One of the rationale of Indo-US collaboration was that USA will get the huge Chinese market. Deng played the googly. Deng did not make the market available to China. What did Deng do? Deng invited the American corporations to put their factories in China, and the factories came to China. And he used these factories with ultra-modern technologies to start producing. And he gave these factories very cheap land, he gave these factories very cheap labor, and these factories started producing goods for nothing. At this stage, factories closed down in the United States, textile factories closed down in the United States, and all factories transferred to China. So the famous googly was played. Market was not given, but locations were given. And the Chinese acquired the world market because their prices were very low. And started the phase when all other countries, including India, had deindustrialization, and China had a huge industrialization. Yet, the 7 American presidents after Nixon did not realize this. Why did they not realize this? They did not realize it because the American corporations were having a gala time. They had cheap labor. They had no democracy. They had totally captive labor who were producing goods at cheap rates. They enjoyed it, and therefore the policy continued. But this would not continue for long. The labor arbitrage reduced, and Maslowian tendencies started. Maslowian meaning that tendencies to get more freedom started. The Chinese labor started protesting against the conditions that they were working in. Deng realized this, that if this goes forward, I will lose all my advantage. All the factories that I have set up in China will vanish. So he started preparing for crushing the Tiananmen agitation. But by this time, his term came to an end. In 1987, his term came to an end. He didn't know what to do. And the supreme policymaker of China, the Politburo, discussed this. There are records of this discussion. They discussed this, what to do. So they said, okay, Deng, you continue as the defense minister. So he kind of retired as the prime minister, but continued as defense minister. Then there are photographs in Getty Images, which you get here. They are very expensive. I couldn't buy them for the book. So in Getty Images, there are photographs of discussions between Deng and the army generals about planning the Tiananmen massacre. Tiananmen massacre happened in June. After the Tiananmen massacre, again there are photographs in Getty Images which show Deng going to every general and congratulating him and patting him on the back. I have got those photographs. And patting all those generals on the back. So the Tiananmen massacre was a planned operation. The first news reports came that 200 people died, 300 people died. Ultimately, it came out that 30,000 people died. There are beautiful photographs of Tiananmen agitation where young Chinese boys are making the Statue of Liberty on Tiananmen Square in Plaster of Paris. But these guys got killed. All these guys got killed. What was the result? The result was that someone had to be blamed for all this. And China doesn't, the Politburo does not let anyone get away. So they started, there are some documents which show that people started planning to execute Deng. The fellow who had brought China to this level, they started planning to execute him. Incidentally here, I must tell you of some earlier incidents. When Mao was discussing with the United States, there was a great revolt in China. So again, Mao wanted a scapegoat, like in India, we have those situations very often. So Mao arrested Deng. This is before Deng became president. And he was in jail for 2 years. His son was beaten up so much that he walks on a wheelchair. One of his brothers was killed. So Deng had gone through that even before he became president. It was only accidentally that 4 years after Mao's death, Deng became the president in 1978, when this famous growth story started, when Deng used all kinds of deception to fool the 7 American presidents and take China forward. So this happened again after the Tiananmen Square massacre. And then Deng didn't know what to do. So he spoke to Bush Sr. And Bush Sr. wrote to him, there's a written letter on record. Again, I found it through the declassified documents. There's a letter on record which says, where Bush writes that, Deng, I have sympathy with you. You did the right thing. But unfortunately, I will not support you in public fora. But if that was so, why write the letter? But the letter was written. It is on record. I have tried to understand why this happened, and I have some explanations in my mind. But I have been very particular that I have not used any diplomatic assessment in this book. I have only quoted the experts in this area, but this letter still bugs me. When the letter came to Deng, naturally, he took that letter to Politburo, and the Politburo said it's not worthwhile to pursue this case, and Deng was let off. Then gradually, Deng died for public memory. In 1997, Deng died. First stage was when he lost prime ministership, and the second stage was he died in 1997. But there are some other dates which are very interesting. The Chinese growth started in 1990. India and China were equal. I have given graphs in the table. But they were almost together. In 2000, the famous banker, Goldman Sachs, started studying various countries in the world. Who's going ahead? Who's not going ahead? And Goldman Sachs found 30 minutes? And Deng found, and Goldman Sachs found that there are only 4 countries in the world which are having a parallel growth path. And what are those 4 countries? Brazil, Russia, India, China. And later on, in 2005, Goldman Sachs added South Africa. So it became a BRICS report. So even the banker felt that China was not growing enough. Why did the banker feel so? Again, because of this brilliant strategist Deng. What he did was that he invested most of the FDI that he received in long-term infrastructural projects. And they started paying back from the year 2005. And after 2005, starts the reversal of the S-curve. It suddenly goes up. It has been shown in India. And India goes with its Hindu rate of growth even after 2005. Between 2005 and 2015, China took over the world. It took over the GDP of United States and became very overconfident. By this time, even Deng had vanished. Deng was nowhere to be seen. Deng had firmly believed in growth with folded hands. Deng had firmly believed that as long as he is growing, the world should not know. But Xi was a different man. Xi was very proud of himself, and Xi is still proud of himself. And Xi's ambassador in the United States said that we have become a very powerful country, no country can touch us. It wouldn't have happened in Deng's time, it happened in Xi's time. There was another phenomenon. There was an interesting man, Ashley Tellis. He was an Indian. In a Carnegie lecture in Bangalore, he said, no, America can't deal with China. They have become very strong in 2014. And Ashley Tellis said, we must smother them with the kindness and convince them that they should stop growing at such miraculous pace. Very stupid, according to me. Surely, Republicans did not appoint him as an ambassador. At this stage, Trump came in, and Trump said, nothing doing, we must contain China. But he didn't know how to do it. So between 2016, when he took over as president, and 2018, though he had announced in his election manifesto, he didn't do anything. He did not attend these conferences. Only in 2018, last year, he started actively opposing China, and China keeps saying that we have the key to the United States. I'll not deal with that key now, but they were nervous. So 2 years Trump took to frame a policy to deal with the United States. So that is the strength of United States today. That is the strength of China today. Lots of my friends say that no, China has overtaken the world. So now I'll come to the last point, the strengths and weaknesses of US and China. I feel very happy. Let me first deal with the weaknesses of China. When China was going through this process, they started manufacturing everything for all over the world. And today, in 2015, they manufactured 28% of world's automobiles, 41% of ships, 80% of world's computers, 90% of world mobile phones, 60% of world's TV sets, etc. And there is a huge list. And these goods were not meant for China alone. There was not so much of demand in China. These goods were meant for the world. But here came Trump. Trump started opposing, and he started talking of tariffs. And the Chinese were nervous that what will happen to these goods. So they started BRI. Get to the markets quickly. Make your goods more approachable to the backward areas, Africa, Middle East, and they started this famous road in Pakistan-occupied territory. Because that road opens them to the entire Indian Ocean. I have been in many consultancy projects in Myanmar. In Myanmar, they started a gas project. Indians had also bid and lost badly, and Chinese got that gas project. And they also constructed a road. That road opens China to the Bay of Bengal. And they started planning for many such roads. They are still planning, they are still constructing. Most of the countries, there was no opposition. But today, even in Pakistan, there is opposition to this road. Even a country which is bankrupt is opposing this project because they realize that China will take over Pakistan. in a couple of years. Most strangely, India has not protested about this road, minor protests. We are lucky that we have a different government who is talking of balancing China. It has scrapped Article 370, 35A, etc., and is more confident. And therefore, it is talking about that road. If that road is killed, Pakistan will be, China will be severely compromised. Chinese were blackmailing us in Doklam. Commander Udabhaskar was mentioning that. They were blackmailing us in Doklam, and we were standing with folded hands when they were constructing the POK road. Now, I see a huge potential of balancing China through these policies. These policies were not there earlier. Let me go back and give one more instance. When Tiananmen Square happened in China, what happened in India? Around the same time, 5 minutes is more than enough. When Tiananmen Square happened in China, what happened in India? In India, the majority community was thrown out in Kashmir. When the majority community was thrown out in Kashmir, two things happened. One, that the majority community in India got against the national government. And second thing which happened was that India's reaction was very weak to the throwing out of this community, with the result that some fringe elements in Pakistan got hold of Indian policy. And Indian policy was with folded hands. We do nothing. We are followers of non-violence. And these people used the exodus in 1991 to their advantage. It is only now that we are trying to reverse that exodus and set the site of Indian community in the correct perspective. Now I come to, and this is the last, now I come to IR3 and IR4, Industrial Revolution 4, 3, 4 and 5. 3, I said, was on the wire. It was on a globalized economy. 4 is also on the wire. That is also digital. 5 is also on the wire or wireless. That is also digital. So IR3, IR4, IR5 are running together. This has never happened in the past. And this IR3, IR4, and IR5 are happening in a period of 50 years. IR1 and IR2 happened in 100 years each. People invested, made out profits. Now in IR3, 4 and 5, the banking practices in India or in the world are not matching with the investment requirement. So all the digital companies in India and in the world are going bankrupt. We have to look after this, that you can't allow IR3, 4 and 5 to act in this manner to your economy. Can India deal with this? Now, I use a very common layman's term that India is very good in jugaad. Two, India has got some very brilliant people like Nadella, who was my neighbor in Delhi at one point of time, like Sundar Pichai. Like, there's so many people who are absolutely brilliant in the digital technologies. And I believe, and it is already happening, that those people will use the digital technologies to their advantage. And IR4 is not only communication sector. IR4 is all manufacturing sector with technologies thrown in on that manufacturing sector. I'll give you one example. Maruti is a factory in Gurgaon. Go and see it. 70% of the workers today in Maruti are robots. 70% are robots. So Maruti was a very profitable factory. So the robots, the fourth industrial revolution, the artificial intelligence came in India first, in Maruti. Now this is happening in Texas also. There are companies the textile companies which are coming back to Texas. Why are they coming back? They're coming back because the price of a robot to run a textile factory is the same in Bangladesh and is the same in the United States, and courtesy Trump, factories are coming back. So this phenomenon will happen all over the world, and there would be a very competitive regime between countries in IR4 and IR5, and this competitive regime, only that person will survive who can use the IT technologies. Well, of course, software will have to be replaced by algorithms, and a number of things will have to be done, but India seems to be most adept in doing these things, and therefore I feel that the biggest education for India is that the countries, all countries, must have policies which are created for their advantage and not for the advantage of others. We very often in India use technologies and use policies to help others. It was never done by Deng, it was never done by China, and I hope henceforth it will not be done by India, and therefore India has a huge advantage. China also started Plan 2025 when it said that they will have factories which are in the next generation technologies which they will set up. But I am sure with the world market behaving erratically, they will not have the advantage, and a real competition will therefore start. So far, China was able to continue with its communist policy. I am sure China will have to go to more democracy. It's already happening in Hong Kong. It's already happening that Deng's son on a wheelchair is the leader of all the democratic forces in China. So whether China will able to convert to democracy and survive, that is a question that we have to see. And whether India will be able to take advantage, we will also have to see. Thank you.
Thank you. It was a very comprehensive, I think, introduction that you've given us. Those who need to leave, you know, could exercise their option now. But what we will do is to have a little QA, and we'll follow the same format. I'll identify almost everyone who wants to ask a question. And please give your name, because we are recording this. And again, I repeat my request, keep it as a question to Mr. Baijal. China is a vast subject, so we'll have a lot of comments. If you can, you know, avoid that, that would be desirable. I'm going to set the ball rolling, Mr. Baijal, if I may, which is that you finished off about lessons for India. So my query really is that if you look at the last 20, 30 years of India and China, when it comes to India's inability to get its act together, does the onus lie with the politician or with the bureaucrat, or was it something to do with the Indian ecosystem that did not allow India, considering that the GDPs were almost comparable at one point in time?
Very often people say that, but in China, even unwise, almost, our BRICS report. So I don't think the Chinese inherently are very brilliant people. Somehow their leaders have molded, and what have they done? Deng's only claim for fame was its policies on meritocracy, which it imported from Singapore. That in politics or in government, only the most brilliant survive, and therefore there was a remark once that if Obama had applied for a post in China, he would have been rejected because he was not educated and experienced enough.
I think then we'll draw, you know, infer the answer, because you have quite spoken about the Indian politician or the Indian system, but that is an aside. Mr. Shashank, our former foreign secretary, I'd like to recognize him first, sir.
Expert on the telecom field, and you talked about all these IR3, 4, 5. Now we are moving towards AI taking over and 5G revolution, where China seems to be in the forefront. So kindly advise us. I mean, it's a running issue. I know that you will not be able to give the, because you might be having a lot of secrets with you. We don't want them. But just give us some so that we can understand the issues better.
You seem to have said that thanks to the US, the Chinese have moved so fast because the WTO and because of American corporations getting permission and doing a great job in China. My question is, had they been given permission to come into India, had we got all that FDI, do you think we would have progressed as far as China? Because we have the bureaucracy, we have kind of all kinds of obstacles, you know, like import restrictions, lack of infrastructure, and inability to control our population, the extent of corruption and so on. You think we could have done as well? And secondly, you know, when you say that Indians use their technology to help other countries, well, that is bound to happen. All our brilliant engineers from IIT either join the MBA or they go abroad and do wonders abroad. So how do you change that?
Thanks. Shailesh Patek from L&T Infrastructure. One of the things that led to China's very speedy construction was taking parts of the PLA army and making them into CRCCs, so China Railway Construction Corporation. Do you think we should try something like that in India?
Advice on 5G. I left TRAI in 2006. And therefore, if at all, my knowledge is very limited. Of course, after 2006, I advised a number of countries on telecom reforms. But those countries were very backward countries. I have not had exposure to 5G, but I have read extensively about 5G. What is happening, what are the speeds, what is the latency, what this can do. But the main problem is, of course, how do you introduce 5G? Because the investment is enormous. And unless 5G comes in the whole country, there are problems. Some of the countries dealt with this problem. For instance, in Japan, in China, they scrapped the 2G networks. They came to 3G networks. 2G networks were inefficient. 3G networks were smarter. 4G networks were next generation networks, so they were even more smarter. They were actually computers. They were actually computers, and the bits were converted into sound. So therefore, they were very cheap networks. In the 2G era, our prices were very low. Today, because of all this halla-gulla that you have sold the country, you have given away spectrum cheap, no one dares to give cheap spectrum. Now, unless we give away the cheapest spectrum, maybe in a manner that the price is backloaded, nothing will happen, and nothing is happening on 5G, and it's the biggest tragedy. Because you have the genius to manage 5G. You have the genius to manage 4th Industrial Revolution and the 5th Industrial Revolution, but nothing is happening. And nothing is happening not because of politicians. Nothing is happening not because of bureaucrats. It is happening because of an overall environment ki tum sare chor ho. Now, all the countries which have gone ahead in 5G have gone ahead with very cheap 5G spectrum prices. I don't think I know more. Second, thanks to, you said about, thanks to USA, if they had chosen India, would it have made any difference? Look, the Chinese were equally corrupt, and the Chinese were actually more corrupt, and the Chinese were equally stupid. I have dealt with the Chinese in the steel sector. They used to construct steel plants of 500,000 capacity. Now, this was heresy. We used to construct steel plants of 3 million ton blast furnace, but they did not. So they were more stupid than us. But they got into an environment, meritocracy, Deng, deception, heavy FDI. Normally, countries fight with each other, have wars, to prevent you from taking me over. But here was a country, United States, which helped China take it over. And who designed all this? It was the genius Deng. Earlier, it was the genius Mao. But those factors were in India also. There were many, many brilliant politicians with whom all of us have worked. But the environment did not get right. I don't know. I'll ask some economist or someone else who's brighter to tell me this. PLA to CIRC, I don't think is a good idea. In India, you have enormous amount of labor. You don't have these problems. The labor gets trained very fast. PLA to CIRC will create more problems than it would solve.
Thank you. Sir, mic band kariye. Okay, we are 10 to 8. I'll request you all to keep your questions really sharp. Introduce yourself and just give the mic to there at the back.
I'm Nathaniel Bodhidhar, sir. And I do an initiative that I call Democracy Within a Continuum. That's a positioning for India. Democracy Within a Continuum. And the Chinese, I understand, do what is called communism in a discontinuum, in the sense that they broke off from the past and don't have the continuity. But my question is really about robots and artificial intelligence that you brought up. If Texas can have a robot which can make a product at a quarter of the price, why shouldn't Shanghai or Chengdu or Guangzhou have the same thing? One, and suppose they did bring robots into China, what happens to the large labor force? And with this miraculous so-called growth of China, have labor costs gone up in China by how much? And where's the competition? Is it Vietnam? And do they manage this better, or will we manage this problem better?
Yeah, Mr. Weigel. Yeah, Sarjit Dudeja. Chinese things are acceptable everywhere in the world, whether it's a food, dress, electronics, everything is acceptable and appreciated. But why not politics?
So my name is Varun Khurana. I have a small question. We in India might have created the biggest telecom networks or the biggest refineries, but we are dependent on a Bechtel or a Huawei to or an Ericsson to build it for us. When will India be a technology creator or a supplier to the world like China?
Three questions. One is about Chinese large labor force, what will happen? This is a question which has been asked for hundreds of years. But you go back in history, never have regulators, never have governments been able to stop technologies going forward. So if there is a superior technology, the superior technology shall take over. So China may be having enormous amount of labor force, but doesn't matter, the new technology shall take over, and there would be a period when everyone would be busy in writing the new technology, as has happened in India, as has happened in China, but no one can stop the march of technology. Chinese politics. Why can't we import Chinese politics? I would love to, because then there would be huge progress, because then the labor, people like you, will be kept in under observation. People like you will be tracked every day. You will not have any democratic rights. You have some restrictions placed by the present government in Kashmir, and everyone is shouting, what's happened to our freedom? What's happened to our freedom? Second, I have heard a professor from Harvard very often, Tarun Khanna. Tarun Khanna justifies, and Tarun Khanna says, that the Chinese system will not last. It is against the human nature, which wants to be independent, which wants to have more freedom. And ultimately, India will take over China. He is the only professor who comes up with this story. I will strongly suggest that you read Tarun Khanna's books, and you will have the answer. I am not such a big expert. This Bechtel, etc., is a usual question. Ki hum kyun nahi karte hain? Are अगर हम कर सकते तो जरूर करते बट हम नहीं कर सकते हैं बिकॉज वी हैव नॉट इन्वेस्टेड सो हैविली इन R&D बट दिस इज हैपनिंग लेट मी टेल यू दैट द नंबर ऑफ इंडियन कंपनीज आर इन्वेस्टिंग हैविली इन R&D एंड परहैप्स दे विल टेक ओवर वन डे इन चाइना दे कुड डू नथिंग एट ऑल बट नाउ दे कैन बिकॉज देयर इन्वेस्टमेंट इन R&D is almost frightening. So these are processes which take place. They don't happen because of our wishes. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Hemant Batra. I studied Chinese in 89 in JNU. My question is like after Deng Xiaoping started the reforms, China education system focused on the skill labor, like creating skills rather than graduates. So that makes that there are too many intellectuals there. So democracy issues will not be treated. And how India is going to compare in next, let's say, 20 years? Because India has intellectual labor, like IT labor, not the cheap labor. And the agricultural reforms are doing very well.
I want to know whether China, my name is V.K. Manchanda, and I want to know whether China has more employment in service sector or in industries. And second thing is that, this is the only.
Thank you.
And how can we increase employment in our country?
Just a very brief reaction. You have explained the evolution of Sino-American relations during the period of Nixon and Deng. As you look back, what do you feel, who took whom for a ride? China took US for a ride or US took China for a ride?
So would you give your
can I? I'm CM Vasudev.
And the last question I'll give it there. You also have a question? Okay, 1 second, then we'll take these three. Maybe I'll do a last round. Sir, you can take these
three. Can I take the third question first? It is without any doubt that China made a fool of the United States. Is it possible that I let another country take over from me the monopoly in the world? You read chapter 6 of my book. All over the last century, United States went through policies where it destroyed its partners. Read chapter 6 of my book. And the same country goes like this and allows China to take over. So first point, that China has made a fool of America. The second question was about employment. Employment doesn't happen in government. Employment doesn't happen in public sector. Employment doesn't happen in manufacturing sector. Employment doesn't happen in factories. Employment happens in many kinds of industries, new industries, services, and all kinds of things. So the country has to design and the country has to discover new employment sources. As far as China is concerned, they will have a huge problem because they have got a very large industrial force which is in manufacturing industry, and they are going to have serious problems because of that. But they are trying very fast. And your question, of course, manufacturing is far ahead of services. They were nothing in services. The Chinese president once came to India and said, ki hamare saath usko wapas bhej dijiye. The chief of Infosys, he will set up some factories in China. So the Chinese don't have that brain which can dwell into the third industrial revolution, fourth industrial revolution, fifth industrial revolution, technology. That is why they went and committed IPR thefts in the United States. These are general things, but ultimately it is the planners, it is the politicians who dictate everything. And I think someone asked questions, who's responsible, politician or bureaucrat? Since I have been a bureaucrat, I know very well that a bureaucrat can do nothing unless he gets a support from a politician. Politician runs the system. Don't have this misimpression ki bureaucrat kuch kar dega. My friend CM Vasudev used to be a very brilliant finance secretary. Let him state that he took India ahead or backwards. You can't state that. Politicians rule the country.
Thank you, sir. Now it's a little after 8 p.m., so we have a norm. Your questions have to be 140 characters. The answers will be 280 characters. So we'll take the banker first. Sir, you can give a Twitter question, and the last I'll give you, sir. Please go ahead. Introduce yourself and ask your question.
Sir, mic bandh kariye. I'm Rakesh Kumar Yadav. My question is, India was never focused on business. We were always focused on democracy, labor reforms, tolerance, and other things, and expecting business to come here. How come?
Sir, my name is Saurav Kumar. Good evening, sir. I forgot. And sir, my question is, after a very long time, we have a resounding stable government, and to use that, but sir, we are talking about innovations, right? One guy also asked about that question, on which you said, obviously, we have not invested that much in innovations. But sir, what we see now is the tyranny that can turn into a tyranny of a majority government, that thing like AMTEC fees has been increased tenfold from 20,000 per year to 2 lakhs per year, sir. This was a very big concern in, recently they were having protest in Ramlila Maidan also. All the students were aspiring for gate admissions and those. So, sir, these things are discouraging an economically weaker section student to pursue research. Don't we see that we are going a back way? In spite, we should be making these things free or less cost.
You see, reform happens far better in a democracy. There are any number of studies. Reform does not happen in closed societies. Reform cannot happen in a communist form of government. Reforms cannot happen in a centralized form of government, because in a communist form of government or a centralized form of government, all the brains are located in Delhi. In a communist form of government, all the brains are located in the minds of the communists. And all over the world, the communists have failed. And again, I go back to Tarun Khanna's book on why India will go forward. And he says that the only reason India will go forward is because of democracy. The second question was about stable government.
The question, sir, is about the MTech fees going from 20,000 to 2 lakhs. Aren't we going backwards in terms of opportunities for youngsters?
You see, you can, as a government, you can decide to subsidize one sector and not subsidize another sector. In the United States, for instance, the fees is very high. But then, the scholarships are very high. Then, merit cum means scholarships are very high. The bank loans are very high. So there are systems which can be managed. If there is good research available in the country, then the students go there, and then they benefit society. It's a very complex question, which I can't answer in this session.
As I said, our endeavor is to finish by 8:15. So before I thank Mr. Bajal and thank all of you for being with us, normally the Habitat has an uneven pattern. After 8 p.m. there is a sort of general scramble. So I want to thank the audience for being here. You know, Bajal Sahab has touched upon a very complex subject, and there are a number of things that I had noted. But I'll only flag two, which would illustrate, I think, this point about China has surged ahead. He uses the word miraculous Chinese story. It is empirically a miracle. To have a GDP growth rate on a base of 1 trillion and sustain double digit for a decade plus almost is extraordinary. That's one macroeconomic indicator. The second is China's track record in poverty alleviation is again phenomenal. By next year, the Chinese leaders have asserted that they would have eradicated poverty up to 96%. That's again an extraordinary figure. And I think India has a lot to learn. And as an analyst, you know, I do not consider myself to be a China expert, but definitely a student. I think one particular area where I think I'd slightly offer a different view from what Mr. Bajal has said about democracy, reforms, authoritarian governments and their own track records, that going back to Mao Zedong's time, 60s onwards, China invested in human development, in education, in health. And he makes a point about recognizing merit. And I think there are cues here, lessons here for India about whether or not, as a democracy, we have addressed poverty alleviation and human development.
And I come to this rather bleak conclusion when I spoke about the ecosystem earlier, that the elite ecosystem of India has let the system down. I'm only making a statement. Perhaps we could discuss it at some other point. But I do want to add one more point that Mr. Baijal had referred to this evening about the IR3, the IR4, and the IR5. If we are in the Industrial Revolution 5 today, and 5G has become the symbol, I want to share this again with you about the Indian ecosystem and the Chinese ecosystem. This is factual. It relates to us in the Navy, and therefore I could speak about it with a little more, shall we say, confidence. Today, the world has the leading telecom scientist. His name is Paul Raj, Professor Paul Raj. He's in Stanford. He is a former naval officer. He did something remarkable in India in underwater, the sonars. And at that time, the Indian ecosystem that I speak about, which is the politician, the bureaucrat, the professionals, and the entire, shall we say, as I said, people who are decision making, were unable to retain this talent. If anything, they made life difficult for him. And he left the Indian Navy and went on to Stanford, where, as I hear it anecdotally, Stanford recognized his talent and gave him a lab and said, you do what you want. And in a matter of a decade plus, he moved on into telecom. And today, he is recognized as the world's leading authority on 5G in the academic world. He was awarded the Marconi Prize, which I'm sure most of you are aware is the Nobel equivalent in telecom. And I've had occasion to meet Professor Paul Raj over the years. And he shared something which to me was, you know, both sad and I think indicative about why I think India may not realize the Tarun Khanna dream, which is that over the years, ever since he made his mark in 5G and telecom, the Chinese for the last 12 to 15 years have given him a blank check and a red carpet and said, you please visit China anytime. And he said, I don't travel so much and I'm not able to. They said, then please allow our students to just sit in on your lectures. No formal admissions, let them sit in. And the same Paul Raj, I'm saying this in the Habitat, in the midst of senior bureaucrats and other members of the Habitat Center, he rarely gets an audience. And we are talking about 5G, which is make or break. And unfortunately, I think, you know, there are many lessons for India, but as I said, I'll leave this for another evening. But allow me, Baijal sir, again, to thank you. I think you have brought a lot of grist for the mill with your book.
Can I answer your
remark? You are the speaker, so you can do anything.
Your remark about Paul Raj, because I have met Paul Raj a number, fortunately, my daughter used to study in Stanford, so I met Paul Raj a number of times. Paul Raj also used to come to try for advising me. I made it a point always not to discuss Paul Raj's advice with anyone in this country, because his advice had to be taken very secretly. I knew that he got the Marconi Prize. I know about his strength. But to say that he was not given audience, he was given audience in many cases. And I think he is in Delhi today, because there is a statement which has come out today, and I invited Paul Raj to come and attend this session. I don't think ever he made me feel that he did not get the proper response. The only problem is that India does not offer that kind of R&D investment which he needs, and Stanford offers. And that is why Stanford and Harvard and United States have gone so far ahead. We are not at a stage that we can offer him unlimited amount of money. I'm also aware that Paul Raj has been offered many times by China. I'm also aware that Tarun Khanna has been offered many times by the Chinese government to come and teach there. But yes, they have collected lots of resources and they can afford it. I don't think we are today in a position to afford that kind of R&D.
I will not, extend this point. I just thought I would share what I've heard anecdotally. Maybe you know more about it since you were in the system. But let's quarantine that. I just want to thank all of you again, and Mr. Pradeep Baijal in particular, and all of you who have made this evening possible. If any of you want to get a copy or get the text of his notes, which are very useful, please give your email ID to either Lakshmi. Lakshmi, just stand up and give your card to that young lady there, or to Sushil, you know, and we'll make sure. In a couple of days, we'll have this lecture up on YouTube also. But in the interim, if there are any students, any serious researchers who want Mr. Bajal's notes, please leave your card or leave your email and we'll make sure you get them. Sir, thank you again, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much. Happy Diwali. Greetings.